will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the laws. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is May 26, 2016, and we are coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, and you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com into the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, and SoundCloud, as well as the next day on Stitcher. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and of violence. I'm actually trying some new things with the sound. I had realized that there are a couple different settings on the microphone since Spreaker moved over. And just to give everybody a background, I don't know who cares about this, but other people that are doing their own podcasts or may want to do their own podcast in the future may care about this, but Spreaker, which is my main application that I use to get the show out live and store the archives, although I have archives on a number of different applications, including my website, but Spreaker I have going back to the beginning of time, and I use it as my main application to broadcast live. So on Spreaker, on the microphone, there are a few different settings for the connection. So I have a mixer that is, it's just for people who want to know, it is a Behringer mixer, and the microphone, of course, is connected through a XLR connection, and the mixer is a USB mixer where you can connect it directly into a USB port. So I have my mixer connected directly into my computer, which is, to me, and I'm not an expert, but I know enough information, I guess I would say, and I think is the best way to do it. I like my setup. Now, there's different ways to do it, and I think there's things about my setup that I could possibly improve or make better. One of the things I'm still working on is my effects processor and getting that hooked up correctly with the setup I have, because I have a mixed minus setup. I'm not going to go into that right now, why I need that, but it's taking a port where I can set up my processor. So I'm trying to find another way to set up my processor, and it sort of works when I set it up, but only on one side. And I got to take the time really to redo my setup so I have the effects processor hooked up as well, because I think that can even improve the sound even better. And I think that the sound is at a very good quality. I think just as good as a radio station, really. And, or most radio stations, I'm sure there's radio stations that have higher quality. Of course, they spend a lot more money on equipment, but it's just as good as any show on the internet. And I'm sure that it mirrors some small radio stations. But anyway, there I found out based on Windows that there are like three or four different settings for the microphone. You know, there is the lowest setting that I had it on, and I have changed that. I started yesterday, and I put it on a higher quality. Although through the headphones, to be honest, it doesn't sound as good. So when I listen to the file that I uploaded to YouTube, you know, it sounded fine. It sounded the same, but it doesn't sound as good through the headphones. And I find myself having to have the faders at a lower level than what I'd usually have them at. So I don't know. If it sounds better, as long as it sounds better on the actual recording that it produces, then that's all that really matters to me. But yeah, it doesn't sound as good coming through the headphones where before it had sounded better. So I don't know that that's that really means anything or that it does, and then I'm gonna listen back to a whole show and be like, oh, this fucking sucks. So because really I think the best place, if I listen to it directly through my computer through the headphones and play it back and see how it sounds, because I don't hear actually what's coming through. So what you guys are hearing, and I think it's on delay as well, but what's coming through to everybody else is not what I'm hearing. I'm hearing what's coming through the mixer and being transferred to the computer into Spreaker. So I'm hearing basically what the mixer is pushing to Spreaker. And just because, you know, the way I'm hearing it through the headphones, doesn't sound as clear doesn't necessarily mean that when it comes through to Spreaker that it doesn't sound as clear, because there, because of that change, it may do something where it's processing it so it sounds better, and I'm sure it is. So anyway, after that long and probably ununderstandable, I don't know that that's a word, explanation, I'd like everybody to know that we are happy to hear from you. If you'd like to call in and have any questions or comments, or would like to bring up anything today, you can reach us at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or you can Skype into the show. A lot more shows now are using Skype. It used to be something where hardly anybody used it for callers. They used it for co-host, and of course I use it for that as well. But a lot more shows now are using it for callers. So if you'd like to call in via Skype, the username is Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Just send a contact request and we will accept it, and let us know your name and what you want to talk about, and we will bring you on the air. Today there's a number of things I want to talk about. I always have a main topic. Our main topic today is we're going to talk about corporate politics and how they kind of control your life, because obviously without a job, where are you at? And it really affects, of course, families a lot more than it affects, you know, the average single person that doesn't have the same type of responsibilities. So we've talked before about corporations kind of controlling your life, but today we're going to talk more about the politics of corporations, which is similar to government in some ways, where the people with the relationships get the promotions. And if you ever notice people that are in jobs that they shouldn't be in, meaning they're not qualified, or they move up quickly, but you don't see them doing a lot of work. Now, that doesn't necessarily always mean that they don't deserve to move up or they don't deserve that promotion or whatnot, because I moved up pretty quickly through one of the companies that I worked at because their turnover was high and I put in a lot of work. Now, I'm not aware if the majority of the people could see that, and maybe they could. But either way, I did put in a lot of work, whether people had seen it or not. And then, of course, you have company drama and all of that bullshit. So we will be talking about that today, but and Katy Reyes will be joining us later in the show. But before we get to that, there are a few things I want to talk about. There's some articles I want to go through. Mainly, I'm just sick of a lot of things when it comes to government. And first of all, I mean, you have this election that is getting 24-hour coverage. You have people that are protesting wherever Trump goes. And personally, I've done a couple shows about Trump, and I can't stand him. He's an arrogant, ignorant fuck. And not that I think anything of Hillary neither, but everybody knows what she is. So with Trump, you have these people that are falling into somebody had mentioned, you know, he could end up being the Trojan horse or whatnot. But you have people that, like Alex Jones and people like that, that are people that follow what the government does and how bad the government is. And it's like Trump is going to save us from the globalists and all this bullshit. And I don't get it. I really don't. And I followed a lot of this stuff. I would listen to all of the YouTube videos, the debates, his town halls. He is totally anti-freedom. He is totally just an arrogant ass who thinks that he's somehow the savior of the world. And it's just, it's ridiculous that so many people have fallen into that. And of course, at the same time, people have fallen into the idea that you have to vote for Democrats or Republicans, and you don't. There are other if you really want to vote. Now, of course, voting doesn't mean anything, especially in a presidential election. It's pointless, and it's all rigged anyway. So it really doesn't matter. People that still think that they can solve the or improve the system through the system, maybe at some point, like 100 years ago, you could have done that, but you can't do that now. If you want to change things, you are not going to be able to change things through the system or following their system. It's they put the rules in place, and they put the rules in place so it's they have the advantage, and you're not going to beat the system through the people that control it. It's not going to happen. So in order to change anything, you have to go outside the system. You have to do things that aren't part of the system to actually change things. But if you insist on voting, they try to brainwash you into, well, there's only the two candidates and you throw your vote away if you vote for somebody else. And really, you throw your vote away if you vote for them. What is the fucking difference? So out of, you know, if half the population votes, and of course half the the whole population is not eligible to vote, but say 100 million people vote, how is voting for the Democrat or the Republican not throwing your vote away? If you actually vote for somebody else, it counts more. That person doesn't get as many votes. So you can actually see it there and make some sort of an impact. But somehow people just, I don't know if it's, if you just keep saying the same thing over and over again. I know that does work to an extent, repetition, or if it's what it is, but people think you cannot vote for a third party. So I wouldn't even bother voting, but if you want to vote, you know, there's the Libertarian Party. Not like even if they got elected, they'd make a difference anyway. But there's other parties out there as well. And they had talked about, at least Trump, that they were cheating, that the Republican Party was cheating because there were delegates going to Ted Cruz in places where Trump got more votes or where he didn't. They just gave the delegates to Cruz. And this is not what people are forgetting is these are political parties and their races. Okay. Now they do get federal money. So from that sense, which is fucked up, they shouldn't get any federal money. But from that sense, you could say that, well, the people have a say because they're getting taxpayer money, but they can do whatever they want because they're their own political parties. Because people are stupid enough to set up a system where there's only two political parties, and these political parties can nominate whoever they want for their nominee. Like in other parties, like the Libertarian Party, they don't have the general public vote, and that's who the nominee is, because it's a party. So they say, this is our party, and within our party, we're going to decide who our candidate is. So even if they did it in a way where they didn't have anybody vote, and of course, you know, it would show even more how rigged things are, but they could do that because it's the political party's candidate. And it's just like an independent candidate can go out there and run, or, you know, another party can run, or just a bunch of people that are independent can run. But of course, they're not going to get any attention. They're not going to be in any debates. So it shows how the system is totally rigged anyway by these two parties and by the powers that be. So, you know, it's really just to see who the powers that be are going to choose to be the president. And you know that whoever it is has made a deal and is controlled anyway. And that's just how it is. So there's a couple articles that I wanted to go over in the news that I had come across. You have the Officer of the Year, and Katy has just joined us from
work
somewhere.
Sorry, I ran late. I had a business meeting, so to speak. Uh-oh, my mic is.
Well, I had it set up for you on that mic.
Yeah.
Well, I don't have time right in the middle of a show to start switching mics.
How does that? Okay, lower the volume a little. Hi. Okay.
And I improved that mic anyway, so you can actually move it.
Okay. It's this thing that I don't like.
This thing moves now like this.
I know, but that's not what I don't like. I don't like this thing because it doesn't stay. All right. Well, anyways, okay. I wanted to ask you a question. Because you know more about this stuff than I do before we move on to your topic.
Okay, after her.
What's the difference between a liberal and a libertarian?
You don't know the difference?
No, that's why I'm asking.
That was kind of loud. a libertarian, depending on, I guess, who you ask now, and that's why I don't use the word libertarian, but some people would consider me a libertarian. People that want limited government, very limited government. Really, to me, I define a libertarian as somebody who doesn't want government, because I don't know how the main thing is supposed to be the non-aggression principle, which means not aggressing against anybody. But government, with any law they pass, essentially aggresses against people. So I don't know how you could be a libertarian and still be for government. But that's really what a libertarian is. A liberal, what it really was, because there was a classical, they call them classical liberals now, but what a liberal really was similar. But now the liberals are like the progressives, the Democrats. So when someone says liberal, they're talking about, you know, the progressive Democrats that are basically, you know, socialists at this point. So does that answer your question?
No.
How does it?
Because you explained what a libertarian is, but you didn't exactly explain what a liberal was.
Well, I said liberals.
Like what do they stand for, basically? What's the difference?
Socialism, in my opinion.
I still don't understand what socialism is. So even though you say that word, I don't understand what that means. Anyways, moving on.
Redistribution of wealth. China, Russia. Well, not Russia anymore, but what Russia used to be, communism, socialism.
Okay.
Basically taking money from the rich and giving it to the poor.
Like Robin Hood?
No, not like Robin Hood, but more welfare, more social programs, more things along those lines.
So that's what? Liberals against guns?
Yep.
Why? That's what I don't understand.
They're for more government. Mm. They want government to be involved in your life. It seems like when it comes to everything, except some social issues.
I don't understand. Then why are they called liberals?
I have no idea. They're really progressives. I don't know why they call them liberals.
Okay.
I call them progressives because liberal really goes back to the classical liberals who were more like libertarians.
Okay.
And constitutionalists and stuff like that, as opposed to liberals now that are progressives and want more government and more government interference in your life and are anti-gun and want the government to, I mean, these are the people that want the government to control everything. They're the Democrats, like Hillary Clinton is the liberal candidate. And then I guess Bernie Sanders would be the extra liberal candidate. I mean, he's admitted he's a socialist. So does that
Yes.
Okay. So I came across a couple of articles, one being very disturbing. A former officer of the year, and this is just crazy. It shows how, you know, how they look at cops and say, oh, this is a good cop, and how really there is no such thing. The former officer of the year, when he was an officer at the Fort Pierce Police Department, I believe this is in Florida, although it does not say. Yeah, I can't find the state. It mentions Champaign, though, so then that might be another state. Anyway, it is Florida. So a former officer of the year in Florida, he was officer of the year in 2011, has been convicted and sentenced to life in prison. See, this is the only times they get in trouble. They don't get in trouble for what they do while they're on the job. They only get in trouble for what they do later, what they do when they're not on the job. And it depends, because a lot of times they won't even get in trouble for that. So it really depends what they're doing when they're not on the job. But usually they don't get in trouble for things they do, you know, when they're not on a job. And usually if you see them get in trouble, it's because they piss somebody off. Like if a cop gets busted for drugs, it's probably because they piss somebody off, or that they're throwing them under the bus. But this, there's no way they can ignore this. So this officer, actually, not only did he have pictures of minors, child pornography, he was engaged in the production and distribution of them. So he got kids as young as 6 years old. Oh, Jesus. I didn't read through this whole thing because I didn't get a chance. But it says, and this is from the Free Thought Project, that they point out that getting a life sentence is incredibly rare. But according to court documents, the videos depicted children as young as 6 years old being raped by adults. And 3 months later, he'd be arrested for strangling and raping two more women. This is even hard to read. So you have somebody who was officer of the year. And this is why I point this out all the time. Like, these officers that, you know, they pull you over and give you an attitude and act like assholes, and they call them the good cops, you know, and, oh, yeah, this cop is a great cop. And it turns out, you know, of course, they're not. But most of the time you never find that out. In this case, obviously, you do. I personally think that anybody with, and this is even hard to talk about, but if somebody has pictures on their computer, because this happens a lot where people will get arrested for having pictures on the computer of kids under 18 or whatnot. And you don't know if they were actually trying to look for them on purpose or what happened. And that's a great way to frame somebody, too. So, I mean, I think possession of something like that, I don't think that it should be illegal. I don't. But if you're creating the fucking thing, that's a whole nother story. If you're creating the pictures, if you're taking the pictures, and we're not just talking about taking pictures of kids, but also rape of kids 6 and younger, and I don't even really know what to say about that. I don't know, Katy.
I've always been very disturbed by child prostitution and pornography. I don't even like to talk about it.
What do you think, though, about, never mind this case, because this is just, I don't know what to say about that. Although, again, it, you know, shows another cop that is a fucking criminal, like most of them are. But do you think somebody should be charged with a crime for having pictures on their computer if they didn't create the pictures? Like, if they went on the internet and went to a website and there were pictures on the website? Because a lot of times, see, this is where I think it's kind of fucked up, because you could end up going to a site and go to the wrong site, or you could have somebody plant pictures on your computer, like open an email and then pictures pop up, and people have done that, you know, to frame people. So you have that. And then, you know, people are going to say this is fucked up, but I still don't think, even if you went out and looked at them and somebody else posted them out there, I do think, obviously, that's fucking sick. But I don't think it's illegal unless you were the one who put them out there in the first place. And, yeah, you know, if you share them, I think that, you know, if you're distributing them to people, but if you just look them up on a website and they're already there.
So even if a person doesn't intend to look for them, they can get arrested for looking them up?
Yeah, if you have child pornography on your computer.
Like his, like the search or history?
If you go to a website, yeah. You know, the FBI actually, because this happened at Free Talk Live, they claim that at the Free Talk Live studios, which is probably the biggest freedom and liberty oriented show in the country, if not the world, they said that somebody from the studio went to this website. The FBI was running the website. What they did was they busted a child porn website, and then they kept it running for about 2 weeks after that, which is pretty fucked up. So basically, the FBI was distributing pornography for at least a couple weeks.
Shut it down completely, because right, then they should have shut it down right away. They're essentially breaking the law as well.
Right, but they're the FBI, so they don't give a fuck if they break the law. But yeah, you're right.
They just wanted to arrest more people.
That's what they would say, that they kept it up.
So why don't they just like continuously keep it up and continue to arrest people? Why shut it down at all? Why not just create a pornography website themselves? They're breaking the law.
Because that's fucked up. Because they're doing the same thing they're arresting people for. They're showing pictures of kids. That's fucked up.
They're breaking the law. They should have shut it down immediately.
Right. So what they did was they kept it up during that time. So I think, of course, anybody running a website that is distributing, you know, pictures and stuff like that.
My opinion is, yes, it should be illegal to be like a member of those websites. But if you like stumble across it by accident, I don't think that that's wrong. I don't think someone should be arrested for that.
But they would be. That's the whole point.
Yeah, that's wrong. It's different if you like intend to be a member for the website and pay for photos because you're condoning the crime. Just like snuff films, you know, like where people get, I don't know, they're all different, but I guess they get raped and then they kill
people.
Yeah, they kill them and they get off on that. Like that's, you know, I feel that should be illegal. So being a member to like purchase photos or, you know, pay to be able to view photos, you know, you're intentional in, God, I can't say that word. intentionally, yes, you know, wanting to see these photos, and I think that's wrong. But I mean, if there's websites where, you know, they're free and you stumble across them by accident, like, I don't think someone should get arrested for that.
No, I don't think so neither.
Or, like if someone shares a photo, like sends them to your email and you're going to open them up, it's your email, you know, that's not fair. How can they prove that you...
Well, if
wanted you, those photos.
If you open the email and it automatically saves it to your computer or puts it in the history or something like that,
can they prove that that happened?
Well, they can write programs where
can't they? You know, research the program if that's what happened.
I don't know. They probably wouldn't care anyway. Because
they should care.
I think the people that they were doing it to, the FBI was doing it.
So the FBI was doing it.
Well, I think that's what happened with Free Talk Live.
See,
as
that's
well.
Wrong.
Well, of course it is, but they don't care. They do whatever they want to do.
But don't you think that, like, for example, you have your defendant, Free Talk Live, they could hire someone to, you know, do that research. Like, they have a right. It's the evidence. You know, in court, they could have their own software tech.
Right, but that costs, that may cost money, or, you know, I don't know what's happened with the case
because
I haven't listened to the show.
Or even, like, you know, because the government, it shouldn't just be the government shouldn't just want to find you guilty no matter what. They should want to find, what's the word, like, absolute... you know, certainty that someone is guilty. And I think the government themselves
should do
that.
They don't care in any case, absolutely.
Why wouldn't they? That's the purpose. That's the purpose of...
You mean beyond a reasonable doubt. They don't care.
That's not right. That's not what the justice system should be.
Well, that's what it is.
If they're going to accuse someone of a crime... I was under the impression that when the government charges you with a crime... They charge you because they feel that there is no doubt that you are guilty. So they should take all steps to make sure that you are, whether you're guilty or innocent, before they even charge you.
Well, I thought you knew how the justice system worked from my case.
Well, that's not right then.
I think that you might have just brought up one of the major issues why... people don't do anything about what's going on because they're totally ignorant to it.
Yeah.
Because
when I saw what happened to you, it was completely surreal. Like, they just wanted... I think what happened to you is they didn't want their police to get in trouble. They didn't want to say that the police was
wrong.
Well,
they wouldn't have gotten in trouble. They don't get in trouble.
But that's what I'm saying. Like, then why charge you?
They
know they would have because you had...
No, they wouldn't. How would the police get in trouble? They would just lose the case.
So what I don't understand is why didn't they just drop the case?
Because they don't want to drop a case. They use it because you need to obey. The city attorney doesn't want to lose a case. They're all about winning and losing and getting promoted and things like that. And that's how it works. So essentially, they're not going to just drop a case. Now, they did drop the case, and the district court case didn't even get prosecuted because it wasn't even a crime. So in that case, I think it was because it was in district court. But the city doesn't have any serious crimes, so they have nothing better to do anyway. So they're not going to drop a case. They don't give a fuck if you're guilty or innocent. They just want to show, hey, we feel you didn't obey. The police say this. We support the police, whatever they do. So we're going to prosecute you, and we're going to find you guilty. And then we can show, look, we won.
That's terrible.
But there's no justice in the, it's the injustice system, not the justice system. There was a, I totally forgot what case it was, but it was, it was a defense attorney got found in contempt of court, and they handcuffed her right in the middle of the court and put her next to the criminals. And then they didn't do anything else after that. They let her go, but because she talked over the judge. And you don't talk over the judge because the judge thinks he's a king. He wasn't even a fucking judge. He was a justice of the peace who probably is elected. So that's what I'm saying. All of these things are, the whole system is fucked up. And going through and voting for people is not going to solve anything. All it's going to do is waste your fucking time. And I was talking about earlier that you have people protesting Trump. Why are you wasting your time protesting Trump when you could be out there protesting something that means something? Or you could be out there not complying with something or organizing or talking to people and letting them know what's going on or whatever. There's so many other things you could be doing that are more productive. So also in speaking of police news, the commissioner of New York City said that marijuana is responsible for the vast majority of violence in the city. So even though they still, of course, keep it illegal in New York City. And I had just watched a documentary, which is, of course, a propagandized documentary on marijuana in Boston. But I think there was one in New York City as well, or that might have been on multiple drugs. But I know they talked about marijuana. But the majority of violence that they're saying is related to marijuana. So if all these states are legalizing marijuana, then, you know, I guess if you have a certain amount, you get like a ticket of something. It says currently New Yorkers will only be fined if found in possession of 25 grams or less. So if you have 25 grams or less, it's against the law, but you just get a fine. But anything else, if you're selling it or you have more than that, then, you know, it's a crime. But to oh, and I actually refer to a SoundCloud user. Speaking of SoundCloud, our show is on SoundCloud. If you're a SoundCloud user, you can listen to the show on SoundCloud. But yeah, he said that the majority of crime is, or the majority of violence, that pot is responsible for it. Yet they sit there and just, you know, let it be illegal and let the violence and the crime continue. So obviously their goal is not to eliminate violence or decrease violence, because if it was, then they would have to look into that. Now, of course, the cops say we don't make the laws, we just enforce them. However, anytime it comes to drugs, they are lobbyists against them. And there's evidence of that, them going to courts, them talking with mayors, city councils. They always go in and say that they believe, you know, they give statistics and things like that, that they believe, oh, if this drug was to be legalized, then it would be bad. Well, it would be bad for them because it would cut into their business. And part of their business may be getting paid off for that drug too. You know, drug dealers pay off police as well. So you have that factor. And I believe I had one more quick story before we get to our main topic. Yes, in Tampa, and this is a really long, no, this is not as long as I thought it was. The other stories were longer. In Tampa, they special operation troops from more than a dozen countries jumped out of helicopters, jumped off of buildings, and expended hundreds of rounds of ammunition as they attempted to rescue the mayor of Florida City. Being Tampa. This was an operation. You don't know how many of these operations that they do, or they have a name for them, where they're not real, but their practices, they do them at schools all the time. They'll have like fake school shootings to practice.
I've heard of those.
And they'll have, you know, fake things like this. And usually what always happens is every time there's a quote unquote terrorist attack or a school shootings, a lot of times they're doing one of these operations. There's a name for them that I can't think of right now. Like during the Boston bombing, they were also doing a, you know, one of these special operations. And it provides cover because then if something goes wrong or people don't ask questions because they know that they're conducting a special operation. But it's crazy that they do this shit. I mean, this one had special forces, Navy SEALs, Marine Raiders, which I've never heard of, Army Green Berets. And it also had other countries such as Ireland and Jordan, which is strange that officers or military from the country of Jordan was there. But the, I guess, story was that he was captured and being held by pirates and that they were going on a mission to rescue him from pirates. And I don't know, it doesn't give a, I guess it was a 30-minute operation. It doesn't give the cost of the operation, but I'm sure that factors in. Of course, they're taking pictures there like it's a big fucking party or big joke. But these things, they're doing them all the time. And again, if you look at when actual things happened, like, again, the Boston bombing, there was a it's bothering me that I can't think of the word. There's a specific word for it, but they were doing one during the Boston bombing. So tax dollars, I guess, well spent. And why they're doing this and what they're preparing for, just like they had Jade Helm over the summer, where they had over the course of 3 months in, I think it was 2 or 3 months, in 7 or 8 states, they had all these special forces that were sort of undercover, but going around doing training. It was very strange. And nothing on that, it was the size of the operation that was kind of unprecedented, that they've never done an operation that big. They do these small ones all the time, but not a big one like that. So anyways, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we will talk about our main topic for the night, the corporations and politics and how they pretty much control your life. So we will talk all about that when we get back. If you'd like to call in, again, 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or you can Skype into the show, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. And we will be right back after this, if I can find what I would like to play. I thought I actually added it to my list. So essentially, I prepare playlists and, oh, there it is. Okay, we'll be right back after this.
Hey, an alien. Yes, I've traveled across space to check on the progress of your species.
Cool. Shall I take you to our leader?
Your what?
Our leader, the guy in charge.
The guy in charge of what?
Well, in charge of everything.
You have one guy in charge of everything?
No, he's in charge of government.
What is government?
Well, government makes the rules for us. It tells us what we can do and what we can't do.
So is government really smart? They come up with wise rules for you to follow?
Well, mostly. But some of its rules are really stupid.
Do you disregard those rules?
No, we have to follow the rules, even if they are stupid or we disagree with them. Government punishes anyone who disobeys the rules.
So you are slaves to government?
No, it's not like that at all. Government works for us, the people. It serves us. We're the boss.
It tells you what to do, and it punishes you with violence if you disobey it, and yet you're its boss?
Yeah.
But there are some things government does that you don't like.
Well, yeah, not everything government does is popular. Like spending on wars, for example.
What is a war?
It's when government basically spends the people's money on weapons and soldiers and then sends them over to the other side of the world to kill a bunch of people over there and destroy their country. I don't like it that government does this.
Well, I can see why you might not like that. Have you humans reached the stage where you generally consider stealing, enslaving, and killing each other to be bad things?
Oh yeah, we know that. Don't steal, don't attack, don't assault.
But you give money to government and they use it to kill people.
Well, yeah. But government does good things with tax money as well.
Why don't you stop paying for the things you don't like and only pay for the good things it does?
No, we can't do that. You can't just decide to stop paying taxes because the rules say that everyone has to pay taxes.
But the rules come from government, though, don't they?
Yeah.
So government made a rule which says that everyone has to pay them money. So everyone pays taxes because if they didn't, government would punish them using violence?
Well, yes, but most people don't mind paying taxes. Most people feel obligated to pay taxes and obey government laws because it's for the good of society. Society needs government, and that means we all have to pay taxes.
So just to make sure I've got this straight, government makes the rules and you feel obligated to follow the rules, even the ones you don't like, and it tells you what to do and threatens to punish you if you don't do what it says. And it uses some of the money that it's taken from you using threats of violence to pay for things you don't like and actually think are immoral, like mass murder.
Yeah, but we can ask it to please tell us to do smart things. And please don't take our money and use it to kill people. We're allowed to ask them to tell us to do what we want them to tell us to do.
Are you guys just scared of this thing? Is government some huge monster that can just squish you at any moment if you disobey?
No, government isn't a monster.
Well, what is it then? Could you draw me a picture of it?
Government isn't really the sort of thing you can draw a picture of.
Maybe you could take me to it. Where is government?
You mean the building?
Government is a building.
No, but the politicians who make up the government have buildings they work from.
So government is a group of these politicians?
Yeah.
Okay, so what species are these politicians?
Well, they're human.
Like you?
Yeah.
So politicians are humans and they're government. You're a human, but you're not government.
No.
So it's the politicians, they're the ones that boss the rest of you around and make you do things you don't want to do and take your money using threats of violence. But even though you're all humans, you're not allowed to boss them around and take their money?
No, they'd put us in a cage if we did that. But look, it's not like the politicians can just do whatever they want. Like, a politician can't just come up to me on the street and make me give him money. They can't do that. Politicians can only do things like that in their job, when they're working for government.
Oh, so politicians aren't government. They just work for government.
Yeah.
Okay, so government isn't a monster, and it isn't a building, and it's not politicians, it's something else. And it employs politicians, who are just regular humans, who get to order everyone else around and take their money. How does a regular human become a politician?
Well, that's the great thing about our government. It's a democracy, and that means that the people actually have the power, because we get to decide who among us get to be the politicians. We get to vote. And if a politician starts doing things we don't like, we can just replace him with someone else at the next election.
So the people that get chosen to be politicians only get to boss people around and take their money for a short time, and then they go back to being regular humans?
Exactly.
That sounds like a powerful position to be in. But if you get to choose who does that, I assume that politicians are always the wisest, most honest, caring and respected people among you.
Well, no, not really. I wouldn't say politicians are known for being honest, or wise, or caring. And they're certainly not the most respected people among us. Come to think of it, most politicians are lying, power-hungry crooks.
The ones you chose?
Yeah, they're always doing things we don't like. They use taxpayers' money to enrich themselves and their friends, and they never keep their promises to voters. They've been caught stealing and lying and taking bribes, and they mostly do what the big corporations want. Yeah, they're always doing stuff like that. They're completely corrupt. They're a bunch of lying crooks.
But you said that most humans know that stealing and beating each other up and killing are wrong. And you said that you have the power because you can change who's in charge. So why don't you just replace the lying, thieving, murderous, crooked politicians with some regular people?
Well, we don't try to elect lying crooks. It just always turns out that way. But we have to have a government because some humans are nasty and might kill or enslave or steal. Civilization just couldn't survive without government.
Let me get this straight. Because you're worried about the small number of nasty people that are willing to kill, enslave and steal, you think it's necessary for your survival to have a system where some humans among you, for a short while, get to call themselves the government, and they get to order everyone else around like slaves and, if they want, commit mass murder overseas, using money they stole using threats of violence. Politicians get to kill, enslave, and steal, Because if they didn't, someone else might? And you try to elect good, honest people to be politicians, but what happens every time is that the people you elect turn out to be corrupt, evil, lying crooks. That's your system.
Yeah, that's pretty much government.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
And we are back. Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Give us a call, because that rhymes with all. That was corny. But if you'd like to call in, 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or Skype in username Nonpartisan Liberty for All and send a contact request. Sometimes I get contact requests, but they're not during the show. And I think they're like those girls that send you contact requests because they're trying to promote their, their business, where they just get naked and you pay them money or something. So I usually ask them if they're like, oh, are you calling about the show, or are you contacting me about the show? And then they just don't say anything, so I delete them, because usually it's not while the show's on. So, oh, there's a thing, add bots. Can you like not add bots? That's what they would call them, like bots. Like they had automatic like robots that would go out and try to promote shit. Anyway, we are back and we are going to talk all about corporations, which I don't know what the ratio is now of small businesses to corporations, because you don't see a lot of small businesses, period. Most of them are, you know, big corporations that have franchises or are just big corporations without franchises. It depends on the business. Like, you will see bars and restaurants, but even restaurants are getting more corporate. Like, you have Applebee's and places like that, and even bars like Buffalo Wild Wings and Dave and Buster's. And it's like and people only look at the positive side to that. They look at, oh, well, we travel and we can just go to, first of all, I don't know why you'd want to go to the same place when you travel that you can just go to down the street from your house. But they're like, oh, they have this, so we can just go, you know, here. And we're going to get to a point where everything's corporate and it's owned by, you know, 10 corporations. And if you fuck up with a couple of those corporations, you won't be able to get a fucking job, because it's like a small amount of corporations controlling everything. But
how do you define a corporation?
I'm sorry, I had your mic down for part of that. You said, how do you define a corporation?
Yeah.
Well, the real definition of a corporation is just from the legal standpoint of they filed as a corporation.
What's the difference between a private owned business and a public owned business?
A privately owned business could technically be a corporation or could be an S corp, mm-hmm, because it's really just their business filings. So most people don't know that. I know that because I have an MBA. That's one of the few things I remember. I don't remember much else. And I don't even think I learned that in my MBA. I think I learned that in my recording industry as a business class that I took from my undergraduate. But I think we probably talked about that in one of the classes. There's a number of types of businesses, well, that wouldn't be the word, types of businesses, but business ways that you can register your business, like sole proprietor, limited liability corporations, limited liability companies, S-corps, which are just a smaller version of a corporation. You pay less taxes, and it's usually when you have a smaller company, but you want to have it as a corporation for whatever reason, and usually have like two shareholders that are the main owners of the business. But yeah, I wouldn't consider that a corporation, even though technically it is a corporation. I'm talking about these big, huge companies is really what I'm talking about. I say corporation, but it may be legally a corporation, but there may be two owners. And yes, from a legal standpoint, it's a corporation, but it's not really what I'm talking about. Really, either way, I mean, what we're talking about can apply to small companies too, but you seem to have the whole political aspect more in big corporations than in smaller companies, because in smaller companies, they're smaller, and most, if it's a company where, say, a restaurant or something, and everybody knows each other and they know the owner, and it's more of a close-knit type thing as opposed to, you know, a big corporation. And it depends how big the corporation is as well, of course. But most companies that are a certain size have that whole political aspect to it where you... It's about who you know, and people will get promoted based on friendships and certain people liking them and stuff like that. And I've seen it happen over and over again. I haven't worked at that many corporations. I mean, all my jobs have been at big corporations, but I've stayed at companies for a while, for the most part. So I've probably really only had four or five, you know, it depends how far back I want to go. I don't really count, like, you know, when I was 18 and I made pizza, I'm not really counting that. But the, you know, since I really, I guess, started a career and graduated from college, I will count those corporations. And it's really the same type of thing where it's all political bullshit. It's all about whose ass you kiss and how you act towards certain people and if they like you and if the you know, the important people like you, then you'll go further than, of course, if they don't. And so I know you've worked for a couple corporations, and they're all retail stores. And I would imagine that a lot more of the politics bullshit and the, not even just the political side, but just the complaining and the, you know, all the stuff that goes on there.
Well, what do you mean exactly? All the stuff that goes on. Do you have a specific question?
Well, I mean, you work at a corporate, you've worked, your last two jobs at least have been for big corporations that own multiple stores.
Well, I've worked, as far as retail stores, I've worked for, the one that I currently work for right now, I know for sure they're privately owned, but they're massive.
Just because they're privately owned doesn't mean they're not a corporation. Okay. It just means they're a private corporation.
Yeah, so I've worked for three. So I know Van Heusen was public because they, you know, they had stock.
And don't mention where you work now because you don't want to.
Oh, yeah, no, I don't work. I don't work at Van Heusen anymore. But and then before that, I worked for Ross. So.
Well, you could talk about where you work now. Just don't mention the name of the company you work for. But so that's what I'm saying. Within that time that you've worked for the place you work for now and the other companies, what, I guess, have you seen or what was your experience regarding the political side of things?
What do you mean by political side?
Well, you've never heard the phrase before, like corporate politics or a political whatever. Like if you're talking about something and, oh, well, it's political or it doesn't have to do with actual politics, but corporate politics kind of resembles the same type of ideas that regular politics do. Like you have to, for example, you have to act a certain way when they go out and get votes and they act a certain way around this person as opposed to this person, and they have to kiss certain people's asses and all that stuff that goes into it. And people make complaints about people, and some of them are made up and some of them are inflated, and some people have a game plan of how they're going to move ahead and who they're going to fuck over to do it, or who they're going to actually fuck to do it, or, you know, depending upon the person.
Yeah, I've seen.
So what are some of the types of experiences that you've had or that you've seen while working for different companies?
Well, not necessarily. Well, where I am right now, I have a manager who's, I don't want to say she's a nut. She's just different. And a lot of people really don't take to her too much. Even me. I have the luxury of keeping my distance because we have several different stores. So, and I'm in one store and she's mainly in another store. And she does everything she can to not, not everything she can to not, but she just, like, stays in one location and I'm in my location. But she just seems to butt heads with, like, a lot of people. And sometimes it can be, like, very stressful for me when people come to me and vent and they go nuts, you know, because they don't necessarily agree with her. And I think it's just lack of communication. Like, there have been times where, like, I feel like she just doesn't get it. She doesn't understand. And we have to have, like, a dragged out conversation for her to finally get it. And then she can be very, like, she doesn't feel that she has to explain her actions. But I think that that's wrong. And sometimes I think people do need an explanation. They do need to know why certain decisions are made. You know, they just do. Like some people, it's not obvious for them. Like, for example, she makes her decision, you know, like when she makes a schedule, it's like a puzzle. There's a reason why the schedule is the way the schedule is to run our business. And not a lot of people understand it that way, and she doesn't want anyone questioning her. Well, why am I working this day, and why am I working that shift, and, you know, why? I'm like, well, there's a reason why, so the business can run smoothly. It's the needs of the business. Who's ever stronger or weaker, you know, works certain shifts. And she doesn't feel that she has to necessarily explain that. And like, well, but people need to know sometimes. And I feel like I'm in the middle, you know, having to like tell her that. And then I have, I have other upper management that they don't really see, you know, when they talk to certain people, you know, they paint a whole different picture than what the real reality is. And then everyone else gets upset. And not everyone feels comfortable to express their, you know, opinions and concerns. And I'm always there saying you have to. If there's something you don't like or something that you don't agree with, you have to speak out. Now, I've had experiences in my other, you know, jobs where it was like it didn't matter whether you said something or not. You know, it is what it is, and it doesn't make a difference. But then it eventually will blow up in their face because I was questioned, well, why didn't you come to me? Why didn't you tell me? I'm like, because I knew and felt that it wouldn't make a difference. And, you know, we have told you and you've ignored us until now. You know, the cards are crumbling, you know, and now you have no choice but to pay attention. I'm like, okay, and I see that. So, okay, here I am.
So did you have a similar experience in your previous job as well?
Yeah, I had a manager who was being protected by upper management.
And why do you see, and that's what I'm talking about too, when you talk about corporate politics and things like that, where there's people that can get away with stuff for whatever reason. So was that because she was friends with that person? Was that because, like, what was the reason why? Because
she was his hire. He selected her. And if she was a bad person, you know, bad decision, you know, it looked poor on them.
Yeah, but wouldn't that happen eventually? Wouldn't they find that out eventually anyway? Or was it that he was trying to hopefully correct everything before people found out?
In the beginning, like, it. Bottom line, his plan was to fire everyone and bring in other people, but the new people as well. Like, okay, for example, my old boss, she worked for the company for 6 years and she had a loyal staff and everyone would, you know, come to work their shift, you know, day in, day out, you know, and if needed, we'd work overtime. You know, we were a productive team. You know, we had our strengths and our weaknesses. You know, she would utilize our strengths and partner where we would lack. And we were very loyal. And then for some reason or another, he got rid of her because, you know, she would challenge him and he didn't like that. And then he had his hire who was basically like his puppet, you know, did everything he said. So he got rid of my old boss, brought in this other manager. She was a total like, ugh. She was just so ununderstanding. Like, what she said went. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. And it's just like, you're going to do this. You're going to do this now. You're going to do it how I tell you. And oh my God, it was horrible. And she was more like, do as I say, not as I do. And, you know, she wasn't in it with us. And we weren't a team. We like totally just, you know, we were a team with each other, but not with her because she wanted things done that just wasn't right for that store. And we would do what she would do, but it wasn't working.
So did you feel like trapped in that situation? Because one of the other things, and I did a show where I focused totally on this, but I wanted to bring this up as well, that obviously where you work at has a lot of control over your life, meaning that not where you work at specifically, but that you need a job. That yeah. Most people need a job unless they're independently wealthy and they're just working for something to do. So did you, I mean, how did that make you feel? Did you feel like you were in a way controlled by the corporation, or not controlled by them, but that they had something over you, like you couldn't just quit, that you had to, you know, either try to find another job, which obviously from what you said you did, or, you know, deal with it? And how do you feel when you're in a situation where you're kind of stuck in that situation and they have that power over you because you need to have a job?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely, my hands were tied, and yeah, I needed a job. They have a power over you because essentially you agreed to do a job, you know, and that's your job, that's your bread and butter. Now me, I was done, you know, I was over it, and I'm like, I need to get out of here. And I searched for another job for months, but I was searching for stuff that I wasn't experienced for, and it was very hard. I couldn't find a job. They said, oh, you don't have enough experience or any experience. And so once I started looking for other retail jobs, that's when I actually started getting called for interviews. And then I had actually found a job right away. So I left. And then where I ended up was not, you know, the store itself. It was so slow and business was failing. Now, mind you, I have, you know, considering for the work, I have a decent salary. So I was like, okay, I have to deal with this, because I wasn't in the mood to look for another job. Because it's like, okay, I worked for one company for 9 years. You know, I decide to up and leave and work for another company. But, oh, so I, because I don't like it, I'm suddenly going to quit and look for another job? No. So I put it in. I said, okay, you know, I'll give it 6 months. You know, at least that'll show my dedication. You know, I gave it a shot. And then next thing I know, another 6 months goes by. And I mean, I do like my job. I hate how it's really slow. But you're right. I can't just, you know, the days that I don't like my job, I can't just quit. You know, it's my job, and, you know, it pays my bills. But I, you know, I made an agreement. They hired me and I agreed to do a job. And
but you can always, you know, just because you agree to something, you can always break that agreement.
No, I can. No, I can. But it's like right now, I'm not exactly in a state where I want to leave. I've been there a year. So if I was to look for another job, you know, I would have credibility because I stuck it out for a year. You know, that shows that I have, you know, a sense of loyalty, and I'm not just going to abandon my position, you know. So if I was to look for another job and they wanted to hire me, they could say, okay, yeah, she doesn't like this place, but, you know, she tried, you know, she worked for a year. She's just not going to up and leave.
Right. Well, it's good anyway to have on your resume, like, a stable job history where you've been at places for a certain amount of time. But I'm asking you too more about, so you have, I'll call it not a system, but say the system of people are expected to, you know, go to school, graduate at least high school, maybe college, then get a job, get married, have kids. It's like there's a system that has been put in place in a way that people are pressured to succumb to and live that way. Now, there's people, and I'm not saying do this, but there's people that live outside that system where, you know, they could travel around the country working odd jobs just to, you know, pay for places to stay, and just their only bills being like their car insurance and gas and food and something like that. Or, you know, different, I guess my point being that everybody feels, or the majority of people feel, that they're trapped in this kind of this system of you go to work every day and you work, you know, whatever, 9 to 5, or, you know, I know with your schedule is a little different, but, you know, it's still a normal type schedule. And in Vegas, people have different schedules where they might work, you know, different hours. But I mean, the it's the same concept where you work this job and with the purpose of probably getting a house at some point, getting married and having kids. And that seems to be reinforced all by, and I put it on, again, the government, because I see that the government has so much control over everything, whether it's media and or, you know, politicians and all of this, everything, government schools. So I see the extent of government control, really, and how far I believe that influences people. Now, a lot of people might disagree with me, but there's a lot of documented information, declassified documents, like that during, I believe, the 20s already, they had a, I think, FBI or whatever became the FBI. I don't know if the FBI was established yet. I think they were, though, because they were one of the earlier agencies. But they already had somebody in with the movie theater companies that they would check with. And then they started doing things later where they had CIA interns. And this is all documented in the government's own declassified documents. So people grow up wanting those things, but how much of it is really, you think, what you want? And what you've just been taught, because your parents reinforce it too. Most people's parents reinforce the same thing as well, as this is how you live. And the one thing, of course, you can't get away from, and I don't think you should unless you lived in a socialist environment, and I don't believe in that, is that you need to be able to have money to live, or you could exchange things to live as well. Like you know, like I said, if a person that traveled around the country, that maybe they did work to stay at somebody's place for a couple months, or, you know, and then moved on or did things like that. When I did the show that you did with me on travel, people were talking about how they get the money to travel, and they were talking about how they'll work a job for a certain amount of time and then save up money and leave, but then while they're traveling, they'll do the same thing as well. Maybe they'll help out at a hostel to get a free room there, or, you know, it the travel show, although we didn't talk about it, it brought up an alternative type lifestyle. And I don't mean alternative like, you know, usually you hear alternative lifestyle like gay or whatever, transsexual or something lifestyle. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but it was a totally different type lifestyle where it was more about the traveling was the goal and what made them happy, and they were more focused on that as opposed to having a family or saving up money for security or those type of things. So what, I guess, are your thoughts on that and how a lot of these things are taught? That doesn't mean that it's not what you want, but have you ever questioned, you know, do I want to live the rest of my life in this, you know, whether it's this, I say 9 to 5, but you know what I mean, you know, working a job or just staying home, being a parent, or having that kind of life that everybody is in a way expected to have?
Well, you know, I've always been one to not be forced to do something I didn't want to do. I will say I didn't chase after my dreams because I was scared of failing. But
that's common with, hold on for a sec, because I want to ask you about that, because that's common in a lot of people. And I think even to an extent that affected me as well, not consciously. I don't think I consciously thought, you know, I'm too scared to pursue certain dreams, but I'm sure it subconsciously affected it. So why do you think that is, and what specifically stopped you, and how were the dreams different from what you're doing?
Well, a lot of it was like, I didn't know where to start. I didn't know, like, how am I going to get connections and contacts, you know, cause I've never been one to market myself. I found myself perfectly happy, you know, when going on my job interviews and applying for a job, and they say, okay, this is what is expected of the job. I was like, okay, I'll do that in exchange for money. And I did have my mom, you know, I was working this retail job, and I had the potential to become a manager, and I didn't even know it, you know, because I cared about my job, because my job paid my bills. You know, I was 21 years old. My dad had just died, and I had no idea what I wanted to do in life, because, you know, I didn't know what I wanted to do in life in high school. I was like, how am I supposed to know all the answers? I had no clue. And I don't think I really had anyone really to help. You know, I did have my mom tell me, you know, you got to go to school, go to school, you'll be successful, you go to school, get into computers, computers is the future. And she was right. But I didn't have anyone to explain to me why. You know, I didn't have anyone to tell me, okay, if you develop computer skills, you can, you know, you'll get a better job where you work better hours, you know, Monday through Friday, 9 to 5, you know, weekends off, paid holidays. Hell, if I had someone tell me that.
Like my schedule.
Like your job.
I'm working 7 to 4, well, on salary.
You know, but I had no clue what I wanted to do. No one, you know, really talked to me. Now, my parents were different because they didn't have jobs that worked out like that. Like, for example, my mother worked this in a convenience store. She was the head of a deli. Yeah, she worked 6 to 2, you know, weekends off, but she could never travel during holidays. It was, you know, or if she could, my dad couldn't, because my dad worked construction. He mostly worked the union. And sometimes, you know, if he was laid off, we couldn't travel, or if he had a job, we couldn't travel. So I grew up is like, work is life. You know, life is work. You know, work comes first. Work pays the bills, puts the food on the table. And then I ended up getting in a job in retail. I have never celebrated a holiday with my family. Never. Not since I was a kid. Not since I started working. Even me and my mom, like, sometimes we would celebrate Thanksgiving like the day before or the day after. You know, because in our job, to work holidays, we'd get paid time and a half. We would prefer the money over, you know, having the holiday off. And then I meet you, you know, and you have all these, you know, this nice schedule. And you're like, it's important. The holidays are important. I'm like, no, it's not. Not to me. Making that extra money is important.
I set out for an office job from the beginning. I mean, I started by getting involved in data entry. And I actually got lucky, really, because I went to one of those temp agencies and they tested me on my data entry skills. And I ended up getting this job. And fortunately for me, it worked out. My boss actually at one point fell in love with me. So literally. So it ended up working out really well. And then from there, of course, I was able to get office jobs from that experience and, you know, led me to, you know, of course, I went to college. I have a master's degree in business. So that, you know, with the experience of data entry and working in an office environment kind of took me, you know, I guess to where I'm at now. But.
Well, as I was saying, you know, like to you, having that day, having a holiday off, you know, to spend it with your loved ones is a luxury you had.
Right. Like this weekend is Memorial Day and I have Monday off.
And me being in retail, I used to get paid time and a half, you know, for work.
Salary,
and now I'm on salary and I have to work regardless. But, you know, that's what it is. I took this responsibility because I didn't want to be at my other job. I just couldn't take it anymore. And it's, you know, it's the agreement you sign on for. And then I have, you know, I have to think about it. I'm like, well, am I willing to change careers? You know, and that means having to take a pay cut, having to start from the bottom. And who's to say you'd even be successful at it? You know, it's scary.
Well, one of the things that is they're saying is going to happen maybe in 10 years or less. And I think this is the last industry I think it to happen in, because you need to try things on. But, you know, everything going online. And to me, again, I mean, the only clothes I buy online is like jerseys or something like that. I don't buy pants online because I want to try them on. But if they come up with some technology that will allow you to somehow see how pants fit you without having to try them on. Now, I don't know what type of technology is out there or what they're working on or any of that, but that may lead to the close of some retail stores.
I think that would be way in the future.
Before you mention anything, because I want to take a quick break, and then when we come back, I want to talk about that, because it's starting already with Wendy's is going to put in automated servers you know, or order takers. But that's a lot different than when it comes to things like retail and when you're talking about clothes. And I don't see how they could do it with clothes, but maybe it's possible. And we can talk about that when we get back. Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Again, check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. You can also check out all the archives at Spreaker.com. Every single show we have done, we are now over 300 shows. Tuesday was show number 300. So there are over 300 shows to listen to. And a lot of the shows are not, I guess, time. I'm trying to think of how to explain it. I was going to say time sensitive, but that's not. Like a lot of the shows you can listen to and they don't necessarily have to be listened to at the time they were done. They're not related to current events, a lot of them. A lot of them are more philosophical type shows because, of course, you know, current events, would you want to listen to a show from a year ago that's talking about what's going on in the news? Probably not. But a lot of the shows are about specific topics, and it doesn't really matter when we did the show, of course, maybe, you know, after a certain amount of time, but listening to some of those shows would be like, you know, we could do the same show now and it would be pretty similar because it's not specific to the what was going on in the news at the time. And other shows, you know, are where we talked about specific things in the news. But I just wanted to mention that as well. Also, if you go to nonpartisanlibertyforall.com, you can find all our links to all our Facebook pages and like those, as well as our Twitter and all of the applications that we're on. So if you're somebody who is always on SoundCloud, but not Spreaker, we're also on SoundCloud and YouTube, and it will give you all that information as well. So we'll be right back after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Tell me more about your leaders. Who is the current leader of your species, and where are they leading you?
We don't have just one leader for the whole planet. The world is divided into countries, and each country has a leader of its own and a government of its own.
You don't have one government that rules the whole planet?
No, this planet is really big, and there are billions of people on it. The world is divided up because people in different places want different kinds of leaders and governments.
How many countries are there?
A couple of hundred, I think.
So there are millions of people per country?
Yes, or hundreds of millions in some of them.
And all the people in a country live under one single government?
There can be layers of government, but there's only one government in each country. That's how it works.
But you can have multiple governments on the same planet?
Yes, and it's better that way. If you had a single government for the whole planet and it turned tyrannical, there'd be nowhere to escape to and no one to oppose it. And I wouldn't want to be ruled by a bunch of people living thousands of miles away on the other side of the planet. It's better having government more local, because then it's more accountable.
How far is it from here to where the rulers of this country live?
The capital of this country is hundreds of miles from here.
So you don't want to be ruled by a bunch of people living thousands of miles away, but you don't mind being ruled by a bunch of people living hundreds of miles away?
That's just how it is, I guess.
Why don't you and your neighbours set up your own country here, so you can keep a close eye on what the individuals acting as your government are doing?
I don't think our government would allow us to do that.
So you have these countries, some big and some small, and the individuals living in each country separately choose which people are going to be their politicians and act as government of that country.
Yes, although not everyone is lucky enough to live in a country where we get to choose our leaders. A lot of countries have kings or dictators or warlords running their government. People in undemocratic countries don't get to choose their leaders.
So you consider yourself lucky because you live under a democratic government, where you, along with millions of other people, get to vote, and whoever gets the highest number of votes becomes leader of the government, the gang that tells you what to do and robs you.
Yes, but there's more to it than that. Democracy isn't the only thing that's great about the government of this country. In fact, democracy itself is not an ideal system at all, everyone knows that. With a pure democracy, the majority rules, because the politicians do whatever the majority of people want them to do, and this can be a problem for minorities. We know this. The real reason why we're lucky in this country is that our government is not a pure democracy, but a republic. With a republic, minority rights are protected against the tyranny of the majority.
How?
Our rights are listed in our constitution, the document that established our government. It lays out how government is supposed to work. It says what government is allowed to do and what it isn't allowed to do.
What does it say government is allowed to do?
Government is allowed to collect taxes for things like national defence.
Hold on. The constitution says that government is allowed to collect taxes. So it says that the individuals who are acting as government are allowed to rob everyone else using threats of violence.
Yeah, but only to do good things.
Where did the constitution come from?
It was written by the founders of this country, the people who first set up the government.
The first politicians of the country?
Yes.
So a bunch of regular people just got together and wrote on a piece of paper that they're allowed to rob everyone else, as long as they call themselves government and call their robbery taxation. Then because they have this special piece of paper, everyone just sits back and lets these guys rob them?
You're missing the point. The founders wrote the constitution to restrain government. They made sure there was a separation of powers, so there were checks and balances in the system. They did this to strictly limit the power, size, and scope of government. They made a list of things the government can do and must do, and everything else the government can't do. They even wrote about specific things that the government can't do, like violating the inalienable rights of the people to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Okay, but I don't see why the piece of paper is so important. I mean, hypothetically, what if the majority of the people want government to do something that the Constitution says government shouldn't do? Couldn't the people vote in politicians who promise to do it for them, regardless of what the Constitution says? How does having your rights listed on an old document help protect your rights today?
Well, if the politicians who get voted in want to pass unconstitutional legislation, then the third branch of government, the judicial, will step in and not let the legislation pass. The founders recognised the problem of democracy, so they gave us a Supreme Court, and their role is to check whether legislation is constitutional or not.
But the Supreme Court is itself part of the government.
Yes, politicians get voted into positions in the executive and legislative branches, but the judicial branch is made up of judges. So if a majority supports the government violating the rights of a minority, the judges of the Supreme Court simply won't let it happen.
Are these Supreme Court judges just regular humans?
Yes.
So how does a regular human become a Supreme Court judge?
They are appointed.
By who?
The politicians.
But then what is to stop the democratically elected politicians just appointing judges who will allow their popular but unconstitutional legislation to pass?
Well, they just aren't allowed to do that.
By who?
By the Constitution.
The piece of paper?
Yes, I admit it's not a perfect system. I suppose what you're saying could happen.
Does the government of this country, which you consider yourself lucky to live under, ever do things its own constitution explicitly forbids?
Yeah, a lot of things, actually. The government is a lot bigger now than it was when the constitution was written. The politicians pay lip service to the constitution, but they trample over our rights anyway.
What about the Supreme Court?
I guess that system hasn't worked very well lately. Government does pass unconstitutional laws all the time. The separation of powers worked for a while, though. It's not a bad system.
Powers were separate? I thought you said that the powers were all in branches of the same government.
Well, yes. The branches of government are totally independent and separate from each other. except that they're all part of the same organization and all funded by taxation.
So when you said the system had checks and balances in it, you meant that the government would check itself and balance itself?
That was the idea.
So let me get this straight. A long time ago, a small bunch of regular humans had a meeting and created a document called a constitution that said that they can rob everyone else, millions of people, using threats of violence to make everyone obey their rules and commands. But so that the masses of the people would let them get away with this robbery and slavery, that small bunch also promised in the same document that there were some things the government would never do, and they described a way to structure government so as to restrain it. But over time, the promises have proven to be worthless, the restraints have proven to be useless, and government has grown significantly in size, power, and scope, violating more and more of the rights of the people. It sounds to me that if the Constitution was written to constrain government, then it's been a complete failure.
Well, the real problem is that people just don't believe in the Constitution anymore. The Constitution only works when people know what it says and why it's important. If people just knew that, then they wouldn't vote for politicians who violate it. An informed populace, that's the only way to really restrain government.
Wait, you said you feel lucky because this country is a republic, not a democracy, and a republic has these supposed checks and balances that prevent government from violating people's rights, even when a majority wants to violate the rights of others. But now you're telling me a republic can only work if people refrain from electing politicians who will violate the rights of others in the first place. That's the same as a democracy. We're back to where we started.
I see your point.
Is there anywhere on the planet where government is, despite the imaginative labels, anything other than a gang of thieves and bullies?
But there'd be chaos without government.
I'm sure that's what they tell you.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne.
That's right, I am your host, Dave Bourne, and you are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All on this Thursday night, our last show of the week. And we are here with our co-host, Katy Reyes. Katy, anything you would like to promote? Probably not, huh?
Promote what?
I don't
know.
Weight loss. I don't know.
I have been trying very hard.
That's not what I meant, but okay. You don't have to promote anything.
Okay.
Like,
well,
if
I will.
One of your friends was selling Avon or something.
Oh well, Vlada.
Or you had a website, but you don't.
Yeah, I can't pronounce her last name. Mary Kay.
Oh, yeah, anyways. She sells Mary Kay. So before we went to break, I had brought up the automation factor and how I've heard that that they're looking into or... I forget the show I was listening to that all, you know, retail businesses will at some point, you know, go away because of all the online businesses. And I don't see that, though, for a couple reasons. One, I mean, I see people wanting to get out the house, and maybe with the amount of, you know, kids growing up.
A lot of times, too, people want to see what they're buying.
Well, I mean,
it's like the oldest trade in the world. You know, no, like me, honestly, I hate buying things online. I like to see what I'm getting for my money. For example, when I decorated my office, when I first got my desk, it was damaged. I was so disappointed.
and I was like anticipating it, and I had actually scoured the city and I couldn't find anything. And then I ordered my desk. It was damaged. I was so mad. I had to return it and pray that the second one wasn't damaged. Thank God it wasn't. Then I ordered a futon. It was totally the wrong color than what I imagined from the pictures I saw online. And then my shelf too. It was completely the wrong like color. But what could I do? I wasn't going to return it and wait, and I just accepted it.
Oh, I didn't know you kept it. That's the same one. I like that one better, actually.
What?
The one that you have.
My shelf?
No, the futon.
No, yeah, I thought it was going to be like a creamy white.
I know, I like the one that you have.
Yeah, well, I didn't. And I was mad. And I didn't want to go through. Plus, it was heavy. And it was inconvenient to send back. At least with my desk, I ordered it from the Home Depot website. So I was able to return it to Home Depot and reorder another one.
But that's the same thing, though. If you get some, I know it takes longer because you got to ship it back. But if you buy something from the store and bring it home and like it's broken inside and you don't know, you know, you still have to bring it back to the store. Of course, the store is a lot closer than if you have to ship it.
But then they also like if it's inconvenient, they will offer to take it to you and assemble it for you.
Oh.
At least they offer that. And then, like I was going to tell you on that clothing thing, just because it looks nice on, what if it's not comfortable? There have been many times where I'll look nice in clothes, but I won't buy them anyways because they make me feel uncomfortable.
Well, so I like you better naked.
When it comes to the trade of, for goods, I think a lot of people still prefer buying things in person. They want to see what they're getting for their money.
Well, there's some people, older people, that won't even buy stuff online, period. They're worried about, like, my mother worries about her credit card information.
Well, she should be.
Well, she has a better chance of them taking the credit card information at the store from the store than online. So that's kind of, but there's plenty of people, older people,
well, not
that
if
don't
she pays
use computers.
Cash.
Well, that's true, but she usually uses a credit card anyway. But there's a lot of older people that that don't even use computers. But as that generation, I don't want to say dies off, but
well, you can. That's a fact.
And there's more, because there's going to be more and more innovation when it comes to computers. So if there's something that,
here's another thing from the retail aspect. You need to coerce someone into buying something, because trust me, I could just have people come into my store and look around and not help them. But the chances of them buying something increase when I do help them, when I show them stuff.
I don't want to be helped. I tell people, leave me alone.
Well, okay, that's fine.
Unless
once
I
you
want
say that,
help.
Yeah,
you
once
know, for
you
a
want
reason.
Help, let's say you're looking at some pants and you think you
pants.
Like these. You think you like these pants, but you try
pants.
Them on and then you're like, stop making fun of me. That's rude. Anyways. So you're looking at these pants and you think you like them, but then you're like, no. And then you're ready to walk. But then the sales associate says, well, what about these? Did you try these? And you're like, well, no, I didn't look at them. Well, why don't you give these a try? Try them on, and you're like, oh, all right. And then you like them.
That would never happen.
Yes, it happens all the time.
Yeah, but I don't talk to the, I don't know.
Is it because they don't talk to you?
Well, I usually don't. I don't
want
to be bothered.
What if it's a cute girl?
Well, I'm engaged.
It doesn't matter. You're at the store.
I'm engaged to you, so it doesn't matter. If it was a cute girl, Before I met you, I would flirt with the cute girls.
It's not about that you're going to do something. It's just that you have this cute girl. She's helping you. And you're like, you know, looking at something she suggested. Oh, okay, I will.
Looking at pants.
And then it turns out you like the pants.
Well,
that's how sales works. Yes,
but I mean, even online, like, things pop up and it could, you know, you can talk to people like sales representatives, and there's new innovation online all the time. So there could be more ideas of how to sell people and how to make it so you're virtually trying on clothes, or, you know, it all depends on the technology that I'm sure will get better and better. But that's all the time we have for tonight. Katy, thank you for appearing on the show.
You're welcome.
And we will be back on Tuesday. So I hope everybody has a good holiday weekend, although I don't support the fucking holiday, but I support the day off, so that's always good. And so, yeah, we will be back on Tuesday. And starting, I believe it's the 4th, we will have a new show for you. Ellen Ball will be appearing with her own new show on Monday, June 4th, and more details to come on that. So thanks, everybody.
You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.